In this video, we are going to discuss the techniques that you need to use in order to cover a student opinion or case study passage. This passage is slightly different than the data table and the experimental passages because there are no tables or figures that you need to look at. It will be strictly reading. So when we attack these passages, we want to first identify the purpose of the study. You want to read the first opinion carefully and identify all the variables that are being tested in it and how they are related to one another. You will be using this study as a control to compare all of the other opinions to, because they will have the exact same variables in them, but they're going to vary what the variables do, the relationships between them slightly. So you have to determine the relationships between them, figure out how that opinion is different than the first. We're going to write a passage map in the margins so that we know exactly what each student said and how the variables are related to one another so we can actually answer the questions quickly. Repeat the passage map for every single one of the different studies. Figure out how they change from one passage to the next. And then we're going to answer the questions and use the same techniques that we used on the previous two types of experiment or science passages to answer the questions. So let's look at this one. As you will notice, there are no data tables or charts on this. It's all strictly reading. So we're just going to read through this. An astronomy class is given the following facts about stellar evolution. Now, when they list out a bunch of facts, one by one by one, I'm just going to scan this to figure out what the facts are. They're going to talk about a pre-MS class star, which means that it's pre-main sequence, and then a main sequence star, that's what the MS stands for, and then a post-MS star. So they're going to be talking about those three different kinds of evolutions of the star. The next part has to do with gravity, and then how the star actually makes its energy by using fusion, and then an MS star becomes a post-MS star when it expands its volume is produced by the majority of its energy by fusing hydrogen into make helium. And so that's talking about the difference between an MS star and a post-MS star. The more massive the star, the more rapidly the star passes through each one of these sequences. Okay, so now we're going to look at what the two students actually said. You will notice that they're talking about three different kinds of stars. They're talking about angle A, which has that mass, angle B, which has that mass, and angle C, which has that mass. And so if I'm going to rank them by mass, it's A, then C, then B. So let's see what student one says about these three stars. The three stars of the angle system are formed at the same time, so that's important. So I'm going to write same time. Angle B was originally the most massive, so B starts with the biggest mass. Became a post-M-class star and expanded its volume while A remained an M-class star. Because the matter of its outer parts, B was more strongly attracted to A than A to the matter of its inner parts of B. This matter flowed from B to A, so B flowed to A, and then at the end, A became the largest star. So let's see what student two said. B was not part of the system. So when we start, B different. A and and C were part of the same system. So A and C, same. But the intersections of the orbits around the center of the galaxy, so B encounters A and C and then becomes part of that same system. B became a post-M1S class star while A and C remain MS stars. B never lost mass. So the order was always A, then C, then B. And then I'm going to write no mass transfer. So, just to recap, we know that the way that the stars are now, A is the largest, C is the second largest, and B is the smallest. Student one said that B started off as the stardust, as the largest, and then B transferred its mass to A, and then A became the largest one. And they were all part of the same system the whole time, so they're all made out of the same stuff. If I look at student opinion two, B was from a different star system. A and C are made out of the same stuff, but no mass was ever transferred, and the order was A, C, and B the whole time. So now let's answer the questions. Based on student two, so they're telling us exactly where to look. B is a part of the present angle system because of which of the following forces exerted on B. So we know that mass attracts mass, and that is gravitational force. Based on student one's discussion, in fact four, so let's look at fact four, which is here. We find that fusion of hydrogen to make helium in its shell surrounding the center. So I'm looking for hydrogen to make helium. So it's not C or D, and it's the shell surrounding the center. So that would be B. I'm going to go down to, because it's a long paragraph, so I'm going to go down to where the question is asking me. Student two would most likely agree with which of the following statements comparing the chemical composition of the present day angle system at the time they were formed. Well, student two said that C and A were part of the same system, so that means that they have to be of the same composition. So A and C, most similar composition, that would be G. The mass of the sun is 2 times 10 to the 30 kilograms. What is the mass of angle C? Well, we know that angle C is 1.7 solar mass units, and so 2 times 7, 1.7 gives you 34, so that's 3.4, so that answer would be C. Remember, the math will never be any more complicated than just doing simple multiplication or simple addition or simple subtraction. Which of the following statements best explains why the reaction described in fact 3 requires high temperatures and pressure? Well, let's see what fact 3 says. Fact 3 says that produces the majority of its energy by fusing protons at its center, making helium. So we know that it's not electrons, so we cross out those two. And protons are positively charged, and like charges attract one another. We know that that's not true. They repel. So the answer has to be G. Based on fact 5 and in student one's discussion, which of the three stars in the angle system, if any, was likely the first to become a MS class star? Well, student one said that B started off with the largest mass. So then that means that our answer has to be B. Based on fact five and student two, would student two agree that by the time A stops being an M class star, angle A will spend as much time being an M class star as angle B? Well, B started off as a M class star. So because B started off as an N class star, the answer would be no. So I know it's not yes. And it's no because A was always a bigger star. Sorry. So there was no transfer of mass, and it was always, A was always larger. So that means that the answer has to be A has always been more massive. So the answer is H. I hope that is helpful. There's some additional practice later on in the course, but you attack them all the same way. Have a nice night.